Hi everyone, thanks for joining us today. I'm Mercedes with Rocky Nook. Today we're gonna have Glenn Randall join us for a webinar inspired by his upcoming book, The Art, Science, and Craft of Great Landscape Photography, the second edition. I wanna thank you all for taking time out of your day to come and join us here. I also want to remind you real quick that we do have a coupon code you can use on any of Glenn Randall's Rocky Nook books. I'll post that in the chat, but the code is GR40. Just apply that at checkout and that'll work on any of Glenn's Rocky Nook books. Glenn Randall is an incredible landscape photographer. He has combined his love of the wilderness with his passion for photography and creates stunning landscape images. His knowledge of atmospheric optics, weather conditions, and the landscapes he photographs allows him to find an intersection between magical light and stunning subject matter, which results in exceptional images, which I'm sure you have seen, which is why you're joining us here today. And I'm not gonna talk much longer because I know you guys are here to see Glenn. So a couple things first. One is, if you have any technical errors as this happens, there's a reconnect button. You can click that and that should help you. You know, bear with us with any technical errors. We're trying our best, but we're all working from home right now, as I'm sure, you know, you guys are all tuning in from home too. The second thing is that you will be sent tomorrow a replay link to watch this webinar again at your convenience. So if you have to get up in the middle and leave, or if, you know, something happens, you can come back tomorrow and watch it again. It won't be live, but you'll be able to see all the great information that Glenn is going to share with us today. And also in that email tomorrow, you'll get that coupon code again that I mentioned, GR40. So that's it from me. I will turn it over to Glenn, who is kind enough to join us today. Hi, Glenn. Good morning or afternoon where you are.
Let's see. So I just turned my video on. There we go. All right. So thank you, Mercedes, for that introduction. And thank you to all of you for your interest in this webinar. We have a great turnout today. I was glancing at the chat and see we've got lots of people from all over the United States. We also have some folks from Germany, from Canada, from England. So thank you all for your interest. So let me mention now that I will be trying to take questions. I will be taking questions at the end of the webinar, but it would be good if you could enter them into the chat as soon as you think of them. Don't wait to the last minute. So enter the question as soon as you think of it, and Mercedes will be monitoring the chat as we go, and she'll be selecting questions that seem to be of the greatest interest to the greatest number of people. I'm sure we won't be able to get to all the questions, but I certainly will get to as many as possible. So, I became a full-time landscape photographer in 1993, and when I wrote the first edition of this book back in 2015, you know, I tried to pack all of the things that I'd learned in that 22-year period into that book. And if I could sum up my approach to that book in 8 words, it would be something like, master the craft and the art will follow. And what I mean by that is that I think that creativity in landscape photography does not occur when you are sitting in a darkened room and poof, you know, this amazing idea pops into your head. I think creativity occurs when you make a new, unexpected, but suddenly obvious connection between seemingly unrelated bits of knowledge already stored in your head. So what I tried to do in the first edition was to give everyone the knowledge that they needed to make those connections and come up with the creative new images that could be your best work. Now, obviously, landscape photography has continued to evolve since 2015, and by 2019, it was obvious it was time for a second edition. So the second edition, you know, tries to take all the strengths of the first edition and build on them. I added a chapter on photographic fundamentals to help less experienced photographers come up to speed, make the rest of the book more understandable. I, you know, amplified the chapter on atmospheric optics, the topic of this webinar. I went through the entire book, of course, and updated all the obsolete apps, you know, all the techniques. So then the second edition has all the latest information on tips and techniques for planning, shooting, and processing images. I replaced almost all the images in the book. I added technical information to the captions for all the new images as well. And basically, you know, if you want to dive deeply into the art science and craft of great landscape photography, I think you'll find a lot of value in this book. All right, now what I'd like to do is I'm going to start screen share and hide that obnoxious little button at the bottom and go to here. So I want to briefly go through the chapters of the second edition, just a sentence about each chapter. So here, of course, is the cover with a new image, of course. Chapter one is called Digital Photography Fundamentals. And of course, that covers what you'd expect, the exposure triangle, depth of field, hyperfocal distance, exposure modes, etc. Chapter two, Landscape Photography Looks So Easy. This chapter discusses seven ways in which viewing the real world differs from viewing a photograph of the real world, and how you can use your understanding of those differences to make better photographs. Chapter three, In Search of Extraordinary Landscapes, basically tips and techniques for finding great subjects. Four, Visualization, how to use maps and various apps like the Photographer's Ephemeris and Sun Surveyor to plan images like this one of the full moon. Enables you to choose your camera position and your focal length of your lens without worrying about depth of field, at least in some situations. Chapter seven, The Perfect Exposure, how light meters work, exposure danger zones, histograms, the four basic exposure strategies. Chapter eight, Digital Capture and Processing of High Contrast Scenes. I think the most interesting and perhaps innovative part of this chapter is a discussion of how our visual system processes high contrast scenes and how you can use that information to make better photographs of high contrast. Find the nodal point to prevent parallax errors, etc. Chapter 10 is The Landscape at Night. A look at my book, Dusk to Dawn, A Guide to Landscape Photography at Night, which is also published by Rocky Nook. And chapter 11 is The Psychology of the Compelling Landscape. You know, it tries to answer the question, can evolution explain why we are drawn to some landscape photographs and indifferent to others? All righty, let's go on from there to the meat of the meat of this webinar, which is the art and science of light for landscape photographers. I'm going to start by going over quickly a couple of basic principles about lighting. First, you need to consider, obviously, the angle of light. This is front light. The sun is directly behind me, usually the least interesting form of light because it tends to make things look flat. You know, the part of our visual system that sees depth is colorblind. It works on luminance values. In other words, it's a black and white system. So look here on, you know, the face of Long's Peak, and you know, you really don't see much in the way of, you know, buttresses, dihedrals, you know, cracks, corners, etc. Compare that to the same mountain from a different angle, but in side light. Side light creates shadows, and shadows give us that illusion of depth and form, which is why it works so well to shoot early and late in the day. It's why it doesn't work very well to shoot in front light or at 12 noon when the shadows are very short. This is top backlight. I'm looking directly toward the sun, but the sun is out of the frame, above the top of the frame. You know, but it makes, you know, it's dramatic light. It makes these flowers glow like stained glass. It also makes those white cumulus clouds back there just be wickedly bright. So very much a exposure danger zone. This is top backlight in a completely different time of year. It works well for this cornice because you can see shadows on both sides of the cornice ridge, and you really get a strong sense of the shape and texture of that wind-sculpted snow. You know, the most dramatic form of backlight, of course, is with the sun in the frame. Can produce, you know, really stunning effects, but also has a lot of exposure challenges. All right, next you want to consider the size of the light source. The sun in a clear sky is a point light source, works really well for grand landscapes, hard shadows, texture, those shadows reveal form and depth. Beautiful. Soft light occurs when the entire sky is overcast, and so the entire sky becomes your light source. It works really well for intimate landscapes. This is beautiful light for these flowers, but you look at those mountains and it's like, eh, you know, there's no real sense of depth or texture. There's no three-dimensional quality to those peaks. And then, of course, the sky is pretty bland. Often the best light for deep canyons is a mixture of hard light and soft light. So on this day, there were a lot of big puffy white cumulus clouds floating around up in the sky. And they acted as reflectors, bouncing light down into the canyon, giving me this kind of moderate contrast that revealed form and texture without being harsh. All right. Now let's get into, you know, you need to consider the color of the light. And the key to understanding the color of light in the atmosphere is to understand scattering. So for our purposes, let's divide scattering into two broad categories. There's scattering of light by particles much smaller than the wavelength of light, meaning air molecules, nitrogen and oxygen primarily. And then there's scattering by particles much larger than the wavelength of light, meaning dust particles or tiny, tiny little water droplets. So let's start with scattering by air molecules. It's called Rayleigh scattering. And what makes Rayleigh scattering important to us is that the amount of scattering that occurs is strongly dependent on the wavelength of light. So light as it comes from the sun is composed of all wavelengths combined, all colors combined. It hits Earth's atmosphere, it begins to scatter. Blue light scatters much more than red light. So when we look up at the sky on a clear day, looking away from the sun, the sky is blue. Now there's nothing blue in a blue sky the way that a blue sweater is blue. A blue sweater is blue because it absorbs all the other wavelengths of light and bounces the blue light to our eyes. You know, air is transparent. The only reason it looks blue is that we are seeing blue light scattered out of the beam of sunlight that has come down to our eyes. The second key principle about Rayleigh scattering is that the amount of scattering that occurs is strongly dependent on the length of the path that the light takes through our atmosphere. So at 12 noon, the sun is straight above. The path length through the atmosphere is relatively short, maybe 7 miles. This is an approximation. During that relatively short path length, some blue light scatters out of the beam, so we see the sky is blue, but we still see the light at Earth's surface is basically white. At sunrise, though, it's a very different story. Here's equivalent of sunrise. Let's say you're standing right here. The light takes this very long path through the atmosphere, perhaps 235 miles, and reaches you at where you're standing there at what's called the tangent point. At that point, most of the blue light is scattered out of the beam, and what's left is red or orange tones. Now imagine that you're photographing Long's Peak, which rises 9,000 feet above the plains of eastern Colorado. Now the light enters Earth's atmosphere, skims the surface out here at the tangent point, comes, you know, another roughly 145 miles, hits the summit of Long's Peak, and pow, you get this wonderful orange light on the summit of Long's because of that extra path length. You know, the exact miles here are not important, but the principle is tall mountains that rise abruptly above the plains can get spectacular light. There's another thing to notice about this photograph, which is that the sky is very blue. Now, the sky is always brightest near the horizon and gets darker as you look higher into the sky. This is another aspect to the way Rayleigh scattering operates. So because I'm looking up really steeply, the sky is a rich blue. It contrasts wonderfully with that orange rock, near complementary colors, and pow, the image wants to jump off the screen. Contrast that with this image. It's properly exposed. Flowers are good exposure, mountains are good exposure, but the sky is very bright and almost white. The reason is, A, there's probably some dust in the air, and B, I'm not looking up very steeply. It's a tall mountain, but it's a long ways away, and I'm pretty high, so I'm not looking up at a steep angle. And so the sky at the horizon is very bright and very pale. All right, that is scattering by small particles, air molecules. Now let's talk about scattering by large particles, meaning dust. Dust obviously creates haze, and here is a very pronounced example of what that looks like, looking west from the summit of Torrey's Peak. You know, each ridge, as you recede farther out into the distance, is more pale, and it shows less contrast. And that's simply because large particles tend to scatter all wavelengths combined and more or less in the forward direction. So large particle scattering, meaning haze, kills that selective sorting of light that gives you, you know, sunrise, you know, rich golden tones at sunrise and sunset. So one year I went over to the Aspen area, you know, to go make this photograph of Castle Peak, and this was the warmest that the light got. Even though it was perfectly clear, this is the warmest the light got at the moment of sunrise. And it was so hazy that when I got out of the mountains, I saw an article in the Aspen Times saying that there had been a gigantic dust storm in Mongolia, halfway around the world, that had kicked so much dust up into the upper parts of the troposphere that it had been carried all the way across the Pacific and had precipitated out over Aspen. So this is the first time I've been defeated by a weather event halfway around the world. It's kind of like a new meaning to the term globalization. Now, dust is not always bad. Dust can also create what are called crepuscular rays or God beams. So it's because the air is so dusty, or in this case has tiny little water droplets, you know, we can see those shafts of light coming through holes in the clouds. Here's another example of crepuscular rays. This is from the summit of La Plata Peak. And a third example, so the blue rays that you see here are caused by those are shadowed air. The direct light from the rising sun, which is still below the horizon, has been blocked by those dense clouds. The warm-toned rays that you see are places where that warm sunrise light has come through holes in the clouds and has lit up the dust in the air, and then that dust has scattered that light to my eyes so that I can see it. All right, let's take what you now know about atmospheric optics, and let's apply that to understanding some specific phenomenon. First of these will be the twilight wedge. So on exceptionally clear mornings, particularly at high altitudes, the twilight wedge appears directly opposite the rising or setting sun about 10 minutes before sunrise or sunset. So here I'm on the summit of Mount Lincoln looking west just before sunrise toward Mount of the Holy Cross. This blue band here is actually Earth's shadow. So this is light that is not yet being hit by direct rays of the rising sun. The sun is still below the horizon from my perspective. This pink air is light that is being hit by the rising sun. And so that during the tremendously long path length through the atmosphere, from the sun to the air molecules out in the distance, 100, 200 miles away, the blue light scatters out of the beam, the pink light eventually backscatters off the air molecules, comes back to my eyes, and that's why I see that pink band. Another example, twilight wedge over Snowmass Mountain and Capitol Peak. Twilight wedge over the Mosquito Range with the moonrise. This is from the summit of Mount Elbert. And twilight wedge over the Yampa Valley near Steamboat. So the reason that this effect is most prominent at high altitude is that when you're up on top of a mountain, your eyes are close to the boundary between the pink air and the blue air. So the boundary looks sharp and the colors seem undiluted. If you're down there in the valley below, your line of sight leads through some blue air and then up into some pink air. So the colors tend to get kind of intermingled. The boundary between the two layers is not very sharp. It's a less dramatic effect than if you're up at high altitude. All right, now let's look at another phenomenon, which I call a gap light. Gap light occurs when the sun finds a narrow gap between dense clouds and the horizon. Happens quite rarely, but when it does happen, it can produce some of the most spectacular color you'll ever see, you know, in the natural world. This is gap light at Grandview Point, Canyonlands. This is a, to understand this now, take a look at this photo, which I shot on a morning without gap light. So there's a little bit of color in the water. You know, obviously the sun is just rising over Twin Sisters. And so there's some warm light coming directly from the sun, but that warm light is diluted by the bright white light from the sky around the sun. And it's like pouring white paint into red paint. You get a pastel. So, you know, it's okay. There's a little color in the water, but it doesn't look like this. So this is Columbine Falls in Rocky Mountain National Park on a gap light morning when the sun has found a gap between dense clouds and the horizon. So now those dense clouds are blocking the bright white light from the sky around the sun. And what's left is this pure, undiluted beam of colorful light blasting through that gap and igniting the foreground. Now, the most likely thing to happen on a morning like this is that the sun will rise into dense gray clouds and it'll be the most boring gray sunrise you've ever seen. And you got up at 1 o'clock in the morning and hiked for 4 hours in the dark for nothing. But if the sun finds that gap, it can produce the image that becomes the cover of your first hardcover coffee table book, which is still in print 15 years after it was first published. And you never know when that bloody alarm goes off at 1 a.m. what's going to happen. You just got to get up and go. So this leads to one of my mottos, which is that the potential reward is always greatest when the odds against you are the longest. All right, now let's talk about glow light. Another rare form of light, very beautiful, comes in basically two varieties, cloudy sky glow light and clear sky glow light. Okay, this is an example of a cloudy sky glow light shot. Now, normally clouds appear to be white. Now, clouds are not actually white in the way that a painted white wall is white. You know, clouds are actually made up of transparent water droplets, but these water droplets are larger than the wavelength of light, so they tend to scatter all wavelengths equally. So at 12 noon, that's why clouds look white or maybe gray, because they're scattering all those wavelengths of light equally. At sunrise, however, you know, this cloud is being bathed in warm sunrise light, and because it scatters all wavelengths equally, we see the cloud is orange, but that orange cloud also bounces light down onto the land, producing this wonderful golden glow on these foreground aspen. Here's another example of cloudy sky glow light. Obviously, these clouds are lighting up, you know, orangey, and they're bouncing warm light down into the canyon here of the Colorado River as seen from Dead Horse Point. So look at the color of the light here in the foreground as well as in the depths of the canyon. Compare that to what it looked like about 20 minutes later. Now the sky is just kind of gray. So the light is much more neutral, closer to white, and the rock just basically looks brown. You know, compare that to this wonderful golden glow, and then now we have something really quite a bit more ordinary. You know, these cloudy sky glow light shots can occur even when the clouds are not in the frame. So in this case, there was a big bank of clouds behind me lighting up pink and casting this wonderful magenta glow over the Green River Overlook in Canyonlands. Look at the color first, but also look at the rich texture here in this weathered Utah juniper, and compare that to what it looked like about 20 minutes later. Contrast is much harsher, light's much more ordinary, sky is kind of a bland blue-white color. It's kind of nothing all that special. Here the glowing clouds were out of frame to the left, and they once again cast this wonderful golden glow onto the foreground aspen as well as onto Capitol Peak, the peaks around Capitol Peak, and these cirrus clouds that were back there. Contrast this image with 20 minutes later when the sun came over the horizon. Now we have yet another photograph of yellow aspen and 14,000 foot peak with this kind of bland sky, and the color is certainly nothing extraordinary. Let's look a little bit more at this question. Let's look at clear sky glow shots. Okay, what typically happens, you know, on a clear morning before sunrise is that the light on the land mostly comes from the blue sky, and just like you see here. And so you get this very pronounced blue cast to the photograph. Like, look at this foreground snow, which is really a very deep blue. Let's look at a more subtle example of that. So these aspen are in the shade. They are lit primarily by the blue sky. So the color of the aspen here are quite different from the color of the aspen in the sun in sort of late afternoon light. That's something to keep in mind, is that shadows tend to be blue on clear days, and that's going to affect the way they're rendered on your sensor. Okay, this is Wetterhorn Peak from the Wetterhorn Basin Overlook, right about at the moment of sunset. And we have some wonderful golden light on this foreground, you know, rock buttress, as well as on Wetterhorn and Coxcomb. But a lot of the image obviously is already in deep shade. So, you know, it's a nice shot. I like it. But look at this by comparison. This is about 30 minutes after sunset. And there's this warm golden glow just suffusing the entire basin. And yet it's still directional. We still see ridges and gullies and buttresses and things like that. This is what the sky looked like to the west that produced the image I just showed you. So this is a strong example of a clear sky glow shot. You know, clear sky glow shots really don't happen all that often. So let's explore what's required to make them happen. So you're the observer, you're standing over here, here's the surface of the Earth. It's 20 minutes before sunrise in this example, or 20 minutes after sunset. The light from the rising sun enters Earth's atmosphere, skims the Earth at the tangent point, comes back up through the atmosphere, and hits what's called the aerosol layer in the stratosphere. So the aerosol layer is composed of tiny, tiny little droplets that are mostly sulfuric acid and water. The origin of these aerosols is ultimately volcanic. You know, big volcanoes, when they go off, really big ones, they can push a stream of sulfur dioxide gas all the way up into the stratosphere. And then through a complex series of chemical reactions, you eventually get sulfuric acid, and water. So during this long path length through the Earth's atmosphere, the sunlight is reddened by our friend Rayleigh scattering. The blue light scatters out of the beam, the red light goes straight through. Now these aerosols are larger than the wavelength of light, so they tend to scatter all wavelengths combined. Now this scattering process, you know, it's not like bouncing off a mirror, you know, it's not a bank shot. It tends to scatter in a variety of directions, but a lot of the rays tend to travel down to your eyes at the observer, and that's what creates that really strong golden glow right near the horizon. So let's look at some more examples here. This is about 20 minutes before sunrise on a really good clear sky glow light morning. We've got this wonderful magenta glow all the way down into the depths of the Colorado River Canyon here from Dead Horse Point. This is about 2 minutes before sunrise. At this point, the golden glow to the east has all faded. And so the light is now, it's kind of a whitish yellowish light coming from the bright sky near the horizon mixed with the blue light from the sky above. And the result is kind of this meh brown color, or at least brown tone to the rock. Now the sun has come over the horizon. It has put a little bit of golden light on those cliffs there in the distance, but most of the frame is still in deep blue shadow. So it's really not all that interesting a light. Now the sun's come down a little deeper. The light's not quite as warm, however. Maybe this is a better compromise. Now the sun has really come down into the canyon, but it's pretty much white light. You know, perhaps this would be your black and white shot that you would convert to black and white or something. One more example of that phenomenon. So here's Monument Basin in Canyonlands, about 20 minutes before sunset. You know, the tops of these towers are still catching some light, as well as the distant cliffs, but most of the frame is down in that deep blue shade. So these rocks are really lit by blue light from the sky above because it was completely clear. Now we have a twilight glow shot. It's kind of a weak twilight glow shot, but the sky's a little bit pink out over the La Salles, and it's bouncing a little bit of warmish light down into the canyons. But now look, you know, 20 minutes after that, or 10 minutes, 15 minutes after that, now we have a very strong, wonderful, you know, magenta glow, just filling Monument Basin, and the sky over the Los Alamos has once again become blue because the twilight wedge has risen and gone out of the frame, you know, above the top of the frame. Another thing you'll notice, particularly right after big volcanic eruptions, is that the sky, roughly 20 minutes before sunrise, can be kind of a deep purple when you look 20, 25 degrees, not purple, it has a purple tint, 20 or 25 degrees above the horizon. So here's that golden glow right at the horizon, the most obvious thing. But this sky has a little bit of a purple tint, and you can particularly see that mix of purple and yellow in the water, which has created kind of this, you know, this rich magenta color. This is an even better example of that purple glow you can see. Now, granted, this is not a particularly well-composed photograph, but it very clearly shows those purple clouds, some purple in the water, and then the purple cast to the sky as well. So let's look at how do we get the purple light. Well, we see purple when our eyes see a combination of red light and blue light. So some of this diagram should be familiar to you. Here's the observer. Sun is below the horizon. It's 20 minutes before sunrise. Here is the tangent point where the light from the sun is just skimming the Earth's surface, back up through the troposphere, hits that aerosol layer, bounces back down to your eyes. Here's that golden glow. But some of that warm light also comes to this part of the atmosphere. Not as much, but some. So where does the blue light come from? Well, some of it's just familiar Rayleigh scattering. Some of it's because some of this air is already in the shadow of the Earth. Some of it because light comes because light from the rising sun takes a much shorter path when it's higher in the atmosphere. So it still contains some blue light. Some of the red light in the beam is absorbed by ozone in the stratosphere. So that's another source of blue light. So we've got a mixture here of blue light and red light, and the result, we see that purple glow. That's 20 minutes before sunrise. Paradoxically, or maybe frustratingly, having recent volcanic eruptions, which have strengthened or made the aerosol layer more dense, can actually tend to kill the warm light you see at the moment of sunrise. So recent volcanic eruptions can enhance the golden glows 20 minutes before sunrise, but tend to kill that golden light at sunrise. And the reason is that sunlight, you know, sunlight entering here, this is our familiar friend Rayleigh scattering, tends to turn red. But sunlight striking the aerosol layer at sunrise takes a much shorter path through less dense air, so it's still close to white. And then that aerosol layer scatters white light down toward the observer. You remember the aerosol layer is composed of large particles, scatters all wavelengths combined. So you get this whitish light scattered down. And again, it tends to dilute the red light coming directly from the sun. All right, now let's talk a little bit about controlling light. You know, the fundamental problem here is that our eyes can see a range of light intensities of around 10,000 to 1 from brightest highlight to deepest shadow. We can only get a range of about 50 to 1 from an inkjet print or a wet darkroom print, either one. So one of the fundamental problems for us as landscape photographers is taking the very broad range of tones we can see in the real world and compressing it down into the much narrower range of tones that we can reproduce in a print. So let's talk about a couple possible solutions here. One solution is just accept it and live with it. I just, you know, expose the shot so that this glacial erratic, this giant boulder, would be coal black, exposed for the sky, you know, created something that was graphically strong, even if it wasn't exactly what my eyes saw. Same idea here. I knew these foreground trees, these distant peaks would all be very dark or black, exposed for the cloud bank, you know, filling the valley below at the moment of sunrise. Let the shadows fall where they may. Another solution, seek out foregrounds and backgrounds that both get either sunrise or sunset light. That can take a lot of scouting, but after a lot of looking around, you know, I found this wonderful orangey outcrop of rock in the Maroon Bell Sumas Wilderness, a few little flowers, and realized that it would get moment of sunrise light, as would Snowmass Mountain and Capitol Peak. So I came back the next morning and made that image. Classic view of turret arch through north window, certain times a year, both arches get moment of sunrise light. Here I was scouting around the Silverjack Reservoir in the San Juans, and I noticed this grove of aspen, 2,000 vertical feet up above the floor of the valley. Got out my binoculars, said, those look pretty good. Got out my map and said, okay, will that grove of aspen get moment of sunset light? And found out to my delight that it was. Backpacked in and shot this photo at sunset. Found some columbine that actually got moment of sunrise light. Pretty hard to find them. They're normally growing down in valleys, of course. Okay, third solution then to controlling light is to use a very wide angle lens so at least some portion of the sky holds detail. So as we've talked about, the sky is always brightest near the horizon. It's darker as you look higher in the sky. By using a very wide angle lens, sure, the sky around the sun is blown out, but I'm now looking so high in the sky that this sky is still blue. Then you put warm light at sunset, backlighting warm translucent aspen leaves, pow, you've got vivid color. They just glow like stained glass. Another example, the same idea. Again, very wide lens. Sky is basically blown out here, but it's wide enough that we got a little bit of pale blue in the upper portions of the frame. All right, polarizers. Before I dive into polarizers, let me say we are getting fairly close to the end of the webinar. If you have not yet entered your questions into the chat, now would be a good time to start thinking about what you might like to ask. Okay. So polarizers are a double-edged sword. You use them when, first off, you need to be looking at 90 degrees to the light. Two, you want to use lenses 70 millimeters or longer on a full-frame camera. Hazy skies, no recent storm. Subject at the same elevation as you are, not really towering over you. And subject a long way away, miles away, in other words. All right, so this is arguably a good use of a polarizing filter. The peak is many miles away. It hasn't snowed recently. Long lens, didn't produce any kind of image that, just screams polarizer, quite like they can. This is an image shot without a polarizer. For comparison, you notice that the sky is almost blank white there over Long's Peak. Put the polarizer on, got a little bit of detail and tone back in the sky, but certainly not enough to make it look, in my view at least, look unnatural. Sometimes, polarizers can help tame that bright sky that we see at sunrise and sunset, as you saw in the previous shot and in this one. This is a bad use of a polarizer. Met some of my rules, mountain a long ways away, long lens, but obviously it has recently snowed. The air is crystal clear. What happens when it rains or snows is that those dust particles in the air act like condensation nuclei. And so the raindrops and snowflakes form around these condensation nuclei and literally wash the atmosphere clean. So here we ended up with this really unnaturally dark cobalt blue sky that I think looks really fake. This is why you do not use a polarizer on your wide angle lens. You get this kind of strange parabolic wedge of dark blue sky with bright sky on either side. It really just screams polarizer. Here I tried to use both a polarizer and a graduated neutral density filter, ended up with this weird, gunmetal gray sky that looks very unnatural. Sometimes the sky is white and there's really not much you can do about that fact. Okay. All right. Polarizers and reflections. So polarizers will sometimes remove reflections from water and sometimes not. And it's important to know when they will and when they won't. This is a shot without a polarizer. I'm looking at 90 degrees to light, and you notice the sky is really quite pale, pretty much blown out, and then the water is also pretty pale. This is the same scene with a polarizer. Now, granted, it really screams polarizer. I think it's over the top, but let me explain what's happening here. So I'm looking at 90 degrees to the light. The light is straight out of view to my left as I, shot the photo. The light from the sky is vertically polarized, meaning it's a wave vibrating in a vertical plane. If that light just barely skims the surface of the water, then it retains that vertical polarization. You can put your polarizer on, rotate it to a horizontal position. That tends to block some of the vertically polarized light from the sky and the vertically polarized light from the water, so they are both darker, and the polarizer kills some of the specular highlights on the leaves, giving them that, you know, unnaturally saturated look. A lot of times, in a situation like that, when the polarizer is so effective, you may be better off to detune the polarizer a little bit. Just rotate it back a little bit from full effectiveness. Now we have a nice blue sky, nice reflection of blue sky. The aspen are still very vivid, but it doesn't scream polarizer the way that previous shot did. Okay, if, however, instead of the light skimming the water surface like in the previous shots, let's say it's plunging down steeply to the water at an angle of 53 degrees measured from a perpendicular. That's called the Brewster angle. And light coming into an air-water interface at that angle, all the light that's reflected is horizontally polarized. So that's why fishermen wear vertically polarized sunglasses. They want to block that horizontally polarized gloss coming off the water surface so they can see down into the water and see the fish. Where this might be useful to you is maybe you're photographing a starfish in a tide pool. You want to kill that reflected light off the surface of the water so you can see the starfish more clearly. Make sure that you're looking down steeply into the water. Adjust your polarizer appropriately. You know, maybe you get a better shot of the starfish. Now we can talk about polarizers and rainbows. You use a polarizer only when shooting with a 70 millimeter or longer lens. To understand that, you need to understand a little bit about how rainbows are formed. But first, we have a little eye candy. Rainbow over Dallas Divide in the San Juans. Rainbow over Cimarron Ridge, again in the San Juans. And my favorite rainbow shot, rainbow over the dike in the Kebler Pass area near Crested Butte. Of course, Murphy's Law of Rainbow Photography dictates that the rainbow will normally appear over the outhouse in the parking lot, not over some magnificent wilderness landscape. Okay, let's explain a little bit how do rainbows form. So raindrops, when they're falling, are essentially spherical. And if a ray of light comes in and hits the drop square, it just penetrates the drop, bounces off the back of the drop, exits the drop in, you know, exactly the direction it came in, and no rainbow. But if the light is hitting the drop other than square, it bends slightly as it enters the drop, which is called refraction, same thing our lenses do, bounces off the back of drop, then exits the drop, bending again. You notice that these rays of light come back in a variety of angles, but there's a concentration of rays right at this 42 degree angle. And that concentration of rays is the rainbow. All right, so here's the one sentence explanation of rainbows. Rainbows form in a circle centered on the antisolar point with an angular radius of 42 degrees. Let me unpack that sentence and make sense of it. So you are the observer, you're standing right here. If you were happened to be in an airplane, you could see a fully circular rainbow. Now, normally we don't see circular rainbows because half the rainbow is blocked by the ground. But if you search on the web, you can find photographs of circular rainbows. That circle is centered on what's called the antisolar point, which is the point directly opposite the sun. So if a ray of light came from the sun, you know, to you, passed through your head, and then struck the ground beyond, that would be the antisolar point. In other words, that at the antisolar point is actually marked by the shadow of your head. This means that the rainbow you see and the rainbow I see are not exactly the same because they're formed by a slightly different set of raindrops. This means that everybody gets their own personal rainbow. Don't you feel special? Okay, then the final point is that the angle between the antisolar point and the arc of the bow, whether you're looking up to the top of the bow or to the far right side, far left side, that angle is always 42 degrees. So let me jump over to Photoshop here and make sense of that. So here's the first practical conclusion from all this theory. Let's say that the sun is 42 degrees above the horizon. That means that the antisolar point is 42 degrees below the horizon. Can you see a rainbow? No, because the rainbow is below ground level. As the sun sets, the antisolar point rises. You remember it's directly opposite the sun. So as the sun goes down, the antisolar point comes up and the rainbow rises. Until at the moment when the sun is about to set, the antisolar point is also on the horizon, and it's a 42 degree angle to the top of the bow, or a 42 degree angle from the antisolar point to where the right limb of the rainbow intersects the horizon, or where the left limb of the rainbow intersects the horizon. So if the sun, you know, the answer, you know, so one practical conclusion is if the sun is more than 42 degrees high in the sky, you can't see a rainbow. There's no reason to chase rainbows in the middle of the day. Let's go back to Lightroom here. So fortunately, this business of 42 degrees, you have a measuring device permanently attached to your body, which will allow you to estimate 42 degrees without digging out your compass. So if you stretch your arms straight out and spread your fingers out as far as possible, touch thumb tip to thumb tip, just as shown here, close your left eye and sight with your right eye past the tip of your left little finger, place that your left little finger on the shadow of your head, which is the antisolar point, and then sight past the tip of your right little finger, that's where the rainbow will appear. You can do this with the, you know, with the right little finger on the shadow of your head as well. So that gives you a real quick and dirty way to estimate, gee, if a rainbow appeared, where exactly would it appear? And now that we understand rainbows, we can come back to polarizers and rainbows. The light from a rainbow is tangentially polarized, meaning the angle of polarization is a tangent to the arc of the bow. So at the top of the arc, the angle of polarization is horizontal. Over here, it's at a diagonal. If this was a full half circle, it could be vertical over here. So if you put a polarizer on and spin it, what you'll see is that the left half of the rainbow will be enhanced and the right half will be extinguished. This is assuming you're using a wide angle lens, and then continue spinning the polarizer and the left half will be extinguished and the right half will be enhanced. Now that's with a wide angle lens. So the secret to shooting rainbows is to use a longer lens, like 70 millimeters or longer. Then you can isolate a portion of the arc of the bow. The angle of polarization is more or less uniform over that small arc of the bow, small section of the bow. The light from behind the rainbow, by definition, is made of all different angles of polarization, of polarized light. So the polarizer will darken the background and the rainbow will pop against that darkened background. So using this knowledge, you can go chase rainbows. If it's rainbow weather, as it was this day in Arches National Park, you can say, okay, you know, the sun is setting due west, let's say, therefore the antisolar point is due east, and therefore the right limb of the bow should intersect the horizon at 90 plus 42 degrees, 132 degrees. So I looked at a map, realized that if I drove to the Garden of Eden Overlook, and if a rainbow were to appear, it would arc up and over the La Salle Mountains, as well as the towers of the Garden of Eden. So I drove there and was waiting and waiting and waiting. And at the last possible moment, the sun dropped into a gap between dense clouds and the horizon. The towers lit up, and to my astonishment, this rainbow appeared. You notice that it's almost all red because the light from the setting sun, after it passes through the atmosphere, there's basically only red light that reaches those raindrops. Okay, so that is a quick blast through atmospheric optics, and a lesson for life. You know, don't kill your personal rainbow. No polarizers on wide angle lenses when you are shooting rainbows. All right, Mercedes, are you there?
Yes.
Yes, very good.
I have a few questions for you already.
Wonderful.
And then, you know, if people continue to have questions, you go ahead and submit them in the chat and we will get to them after the ones I already have here.
Fantastic.
Let me start with this question. A lot of people tend to ask questions that's very specific about gear. And I don't really like asking them in the webinars because one person's question about gear is specific to their own gear. It doesn't really apply to everyone. Mm-hmm. So if you could maybe take a broader approach and talk about, you know, if you talk about gear in the book, and the two questions we did have that I thought were kind of applicable were, you know, what gear or lenses do you recommend for astrophotography, and what do you personally shoot with?
Okay, so I shoot with Canon equipment, which is not to say that Sony and Nikon and Olympus equipment is inferior. It's just where I landed for reasons too elaborate to explain right here. My standard lens assortment that goes with me everywhere is a 16-35 f/2.8, a 50 millimeter compact macro, and a 70-200 millimeter f/4 LIS. Now, I am primarily, almost exclusively, a landscape photographer, but that's the range of focal lengths that I want to have available to me. Obviously, you could achieve that range with any number of different lenses, you know, to get to that combination. But that's what I ended up with. I wanted to have that assortment with me always. Then I have a variety of specialized lenses for specialized purposes. I do carry a 24 millimeter tilt shift lens for shooting wildflowers, shooting fall colors because it helps keep trees parallel. For astrophotography, there's sort of two broad categories of lenses that work really well. There are the ultra wide angle, moderately fast lenses like a 16-35 f/2.8, 14-24 in the Nikon series of lenses. And then there are ultra fast, moderately wide lenses like a 35 millimeter f/1.4. You know, that's a pretty complex discussion as to why you would want both. But to summarize, if you're just starting out, an ultra wide, moderately fast lens like a 16-35 f/2.8 is a great place to start. And as you dive into it more deeply, you might want to add specialized lenses like a 35 millimeter f/1.4 because they have much better light gathering power and you'll get cleaner images than you will with an ultra wide angle but slower lens. Big disadvantage of the 35 f/1.4 is narrower angle of view, meaning you end up doing a lot of panoramas, sometimes multi-row panoramas. Then you have a much more complex shooting process, much more complex stitching process. It just sort of magnifies the difficulty of the whole project.
Yeah, thank you. We had questions come in about your post-processing methods.
Now that's a very, very big topic. I guess, you know, if I were to sort of summarize my overall approach, it'd be to summarize the philosophy, which is that to say, I think authenticity still matters. You know, my goal in shooting and then processing daytime images is I want to be able to say to the viewers of my photographs, you know, what you see in my photograph is what I saw through the lens. That's not to say what I saw with my eyes, because my eyes have much better dynamic range than my sensor does, even the best sensors today. But my goal is authenticity. So I regard any technique in Lightroom or in Photoshop as fair play, so long as it produces an image that's closer to what my eyes saw. So if I'm opening up shadows, bringing down highlights, that's making it more natural. That's making it closer to what I saw. The situation gets a lot muddier at night. You know, at night, we basically don't see color. At night, our cameras are much better than our eyes are at recording color. So how do you deal with that fact? Well, my solution has been to say, and this is very subjective, that I want to make an image that captures the feeling that I had when I was standing there. So yes, I shoot in color, but I do shift the color of the night sky toward the blue that we all imagine it ought to be, even though on a moonless night, the sky actually is not blue. It's usually some shade of green, which looks very unnatural to us, even though that is those are the actual wavelengths present in the scene. So I shift the color of the sky toward blue, but I preserve the color of the highlights where I can see color, meaning bright stars and, of course, planets. So Mars, of course, famously the red planet, you know, Aldebaran, Arcturus, Betelgeuse, Antares all have a reddish glow to them. Rigel, Sirius have kind of a blue-white tinge to them. So I preserve the colors of the stars, but I shift the color of the light, the color of the sky toward blue. And then for the land, I shift it slightly toward blue to preserve the impression we have that, say, moonlight landscapes are bluish. Without trying to dive into Lightroom and Photoshop, that's my overall philosophy. Now, in the book, both in Art, Science, and Craft, and in Dusk to Dawn, A Guide to Landscape Photography at Night, I dive into this much more deeply with a lot of detailed point-by-point, blow-by-blow instructions on exactly how you achieve those goals in Lightroom and in Photoshop.
Great. One question that I thought was interesting was about when you're shooting an image that contains a reflection, like the, you know, you showed one really beautiful one with that. Mm-hmm. They were asking, do you focus on the subject that's being reflected, or do you focus on the surface that's doing the reflecting?
That's a great question. Reflections are actually at infinity. So in other words, if let's say the mountain is a mile away, you know, that's optically, that's at infinity for any lens. A reflection of that mountain is also optically a mile away. You would focus at infinity. Now, where it gets more tricky is if there's a rock sticking out of the water surface that happens to be right next to the reflection of the summit of the mountain that's a mile away. Well, that rock may be only 10 feet away. So you may actually have very significant depth of field issues, depending on the lens you're shooting, et cetera, you know, aperture, et cetera, because you have to get full, in that example, you'd have to get full depth of field from 10 feet to infinity. Yeah, but interestingly enough, reflections are at infinite distance. And the reason is that an object at infinite distance, the rays of light coming from it are essentially parallel. And when they reflect off that water surface, angle of incidence equals angle of reflection. So they're still parallel. And because both sets of rays from reflection and subject are parallel, they're essentially at optically at infinity.
Wow, that's really cool. Thank you for explaining. let's see, what other questions do I have here for you? Do you post-process the local white balance in shadows or leave it natural?
Almost always I leave it natural if it's a grand landscape. So yes, the light is blue in the shadows, but I leave it blue. And I just kind of keep that in mind as I'm composing shots and choosing subjects. On occasion, if it's just a close-up of flowers, you know, on a really clear day and they're in shadow and they're like yellow flowers, I will warm that up slightly because of a phenomenon called color constancy. My eyes saw those yellow flowers lit by deep blue light as warmer in tone than my sensor recorded them. So I regard it as fair pool in that situation, just a close-up of flowers to warm them up slightly. Now, I don't warm up the light all the way to daylight because I think that looks really unnatural. But I do warm it up on occasion a little bit.
Great. So I don't know if you can answer this question in the time we have left, but we'll see. Someone's asking, please briefly explain hyperfocal length and focusing distant objects.
Okay. Well, in brief, the hyperfocal distance is the distance at which you photograph, a distance at which you focus, excuse me, to achieve the maximum depth of field you can get from a given focal length lens and a given aperture. So an example would be the hyperfocal distance for a 24 millimeter lens, full frame camera at f/22 is 4 feet 4 inches. So you would photograph the lens at an object that's 4 feet 4 inches away and then expect depth of field from half that distance to infinity. So your depth of field would extend from 2 feet 2 inches to infinity. And there are lots of hyperfocal calculators available in smartphone apps and online and everything, which are really useful if you're trying to make that kind of calculation.
Great. Thank you. Do you use manual or auto white balance?
Manual white balance always for landscapes. So when you're using a manual white balance and you choose daylight as your manual white balance, what you're essentially telling the camera is, don't ditz with the color. Show me the colors actually present in the scene. And if I am so fortunate as to be out there shooting at sunrise or sunset and the whole sky's lighting up pink, I want the camera to record those pink tones. I don't want it to ditz with the color. Auto white balance is a tool that's highly useful for wedding photographers because they want to keep white wedding dresses white regardless of the color of the light. So 12 noon daylight is white, but then the bride steps into the shadows and now she's lit by blue light from the blue sky. And then she's at the altar and she's lit by orange light from the tungsten bulbs above the altar. And then she's at the reception and she's lit by green light from those cheap fluorescents at the reception. You know, you don't want a sunburned bride or a seasick bride or a cold dead blue bride. You know, you want a properly exposed white dress and you want natural flesh tones for the bride. So for that purpose, auto white balance is a great tool.
Okay. So I don't have any more questions from you. It looks like the chat's drying up a little bit too.
All right.
I just want to give you a moment to, you know, say anything else you want to say about your book that's coming out. We do think it will be available in print in August. It has been delayed a little bit because of the coronavirus situation. So anything else you want to say about that book, or if you want to take a minute, let people know where they can find you online and anything else you might have coming up?
Sure. So yeah, I'm delighted with the book. I actually feel very good about how much I was able to change the first edition to make it into the second edition. I think it's a substantial improvement. Part of what made it better, I think, is that, you know, I've been teaching landscape photography workshops for more than 15 years. And there's nothing like having to explain a complicated subject to a live audience to show you the gaps in your own knowledge, because you suddenly realize, I didn't really understand what I just tried to say. And it also shows you where the students have problems. So, you know, it's been 5 years since that first edition. I've tried to take everything I've learned over all of my teaching and put that into the book so that the explanations, I hope, are very much crystal clear and really easy to follow, because I've seen places where students stumble and need more explanation. They need another illustration or whatever. So I hope you'll check out the book. And then I do teach a full range of workshops, both group workshops and private workshops. You can find me, of course, online at www.glennrandall.com. A lot of the workshops are already full, but there are still some spaces available in some workshops. And I teach private landscape photography workshops as well, meaning one-on-one, either online, you know, portfolio reviews, if that'd be helpful to you, or in person in Rocky Mountain National Park. We can go out and shoot together and I'll help you, you know, make the best possible images. I would like to emphasize, I do not shoot my own images during your workshop, either private or group. My goal is solely, my attention is solely focused on helping you make the best possible images. So hope to see you online or in the field someday.
That's great. Thank you so much. Just for everyone else who's here, I just want to thank you so much for joining us today for this webinar. Glenn, I just want to tell you, I noticed in the chat, especially towards the end, that everyone was saying, you know, thank you so much. This is really helpful. And
thank you. Thank you to everyone who attended. It was a great turnout. So
yeah, it was a great webinar. And so for everyone who attended, tomorrow you'll be emailed a replay link if you want to watch the video again or revisit something specific that Glenn talked about. You're welcome to do that with that link. That'll be emailed to you tomorrow. And that will also include the coupon code, which I did post in the chat earlier, which is GR40, which takes 40% off any of Glenn's books at rockynook.com. That coupon code won't work on Amazon, so don't try it there. Otherwise, I think that's it for like the little housekeeping things I had to mention. And just want to thank you again for joining us and thank everyone else for showing up today.
Yes, thank you all.
Have a good one. Bye, Glenn.
Goodbye.